Thanks, Hitesh. Thanks for giving me this opportunity to be here. Friends, what I have done is that I'm discussing few clinical scenario for the treatment, and will as we move on. Well, the first is the objective of treatment in TB spine has changed from acceptance of a healing of disease with deformity to present aim of healing of lesion with near normal spine. And in last 30 years, lot of scenario has changed, and hence it's the time to have a look at, fresh look at an old disease. And this is largely possible because of improvement in the diagnostics or a confirmation of diagnosis, chemotherapy, surgical principle, implant use in infection, and overall understanding of pathological process of disease and complications. Well, we all know that 98% is a paradiscal lesion, and before a lesion starts by inflammation, it ends up in a loss of bone height as a kyphosis. It takes about 3 to 4 months time, and during this time patient remain symptomatic. And if we use that window of opportunity where patient is symptomatic but at the same time patient doesn't show any loss of bone height or doesn't show or very minimal radiological sign, then with the current imaging we can diagnose. If at that stage, then we can treat and correct, get the healed status without a deformity being appeared. And this is largely possible if it is suspected clinical or clinico-radiologically. So any patient with persistent localized back pain for 6 to 12 weeks or more, with or without constitutional symptom in an endemic region for tuberculosis, should be kept as an observation spine, and one should keep on evaluating and every now and then clinically and 6 weeks radiologically for an earliest reduction of disc space on follow-up x-rays, or else they must be taken up for imaging. And that's how one diagnosis can be done well before a deformity developed in a pre-classical stage to achieve healing with no or minimal deformity. And this is the example. This young patient, if you look at this patient, has a persistent pain, and this disc space shows a slight reduction from the above, and this is the MRI which shows a two vertebral disease, and one could see here on T2 weighted and T1 weighted a paravertebral shadow as well. So if by any means you are able to diagnose the disease at this stage and start treatment, then I'm sure the patient is going to heal without deformity. Well, MRI has made lot of changes and lot of assurance as far as diagnosis is concerned. And these MR feature of a contiguous vertebral body involvement with preserved intervertebral disc spaces with pre and paravertebral shadow, which is changing signal as T1 and T2 weighted images, septate paravertebral shadow, intraosseous abscess and epidural encroachment, then we are more or less sure that we are dealing with a case of TB spine. And this article is published in this early January issue of International Orthopedics. Well, coming to the treatment, first of all, TB is a medical disease, whether it is pulmonary tuberculosis or osteoarticular or spinal tuberculosis. We only operate for complications, either a neural complications or deformity. And hence, ambulant chemotherapy where ATT, bed rest and suitable braces is the treatment to be offered. Well, regimen and duration, these are the two issues most discussed. Well, for regimen, whether you give a DOTS regimen or you give a daily doses regimen, both has scientific rationally, both are right. The only thing, they are not interchangeable. You cannot give the drug doses of daily doses regimen to DOTS or DOTS and vice versa. Coming to duration, yes, this is the issue which has not been answered, which all of us have to work for it. I have just completed a long analysis where I have taken MRI as a healed status, and I could find in their study of 51 cases that only 35% achieve healed status at the end of 8 months. And one could see here, this is what is a starting MRI, and this is what at the end of 8 months, and this healed status has been achieved only in 35% instances. While there is another category of patient which at 8 months time has a persistent of disease activity and hence continued on ATT, and at 12 months they achieved healed status, and we could achieve healed status in 60% cases only. So the message is that probably the best course is that we cannot keep these patients on some fixed duration of treatment. We have to evaluate at the end of 8 months or at the end of 12 months on a contrast MRI to know whether the patient has achieved healed status or not. Well, uncomplicated TB spine, indication of surgery is diagnostic dilemma. When lesion doesn't have a classical clinical radiological imaging feature of TB and lesion is there is a suspect diagnosis, then make all attempt to make a histological diagnosis, as there is no place for trial or treatment for TB spine. Second is a panvertebral lesion, when disease has destroyed anteriorly and posterior column of the vertebral body, or a severe or progressive kyphosis. And this is if in a case of TB spine, if you get an APU view, a slightest of scoliosis, then we are sure that we are dealing with a lesion which has a destruction of anterior body as well as posterior complex. And these are the patients, if they are not taken care of at this time, the spine is going to translate, proximal spine is going to translate on distal spine, and patient is going to have severe neural deficit which will be resistant to recovery in spite of good reduction, and hence this stage should be prevented. Well, MRI has added another facets. You get every day an MRI report showing patient of TB spine with a severe intraspinal compression. Well, should we operate all such patients? Well, for that we evaluated a series of 15 patients who had no neural deficit, but then they had MR based cord compression, and we calculated if there is no evidence of instability present in term of a panvertebral disease, then up to 76% canal encroachment is compatible with intact neural state. That puts us to the thing that only those patients who have an indication of surgery for neurology or instability should be taken for surgery and not on MR based pictures. TB spine with deformity, well, we know once a case of TB spine is diagnosed in adult, kyphosis continues to increase even on treatment. On non-operative treatment, average increase is by 15 degree, and 3 to 5% have more than 60 degree kyphotic deformity. And on surgery, this increases more because we have removed the disease segment, we have bridged it with the bone graft, and bone graft is weakest on the day it has been put in, and hence this graft may have graft related complications, and this kyphosis will increase in some course of time. However, once a disease heals, this kyphosis does not progress. So which kyphosis is to be corrected in a classical disease? Identify those kyphosis which are going to progress 60 degree or more at healing of lesion in dorsal and dorsal lumbar spine. And Rajashekaran has given this formula. We also have tested this formula, and we came out that any case with initial vertebral body loss of more than 1.5 vertebral body height in a dorsal lumbar spine would end up in a healed kyphosis of 60 degree or more, and it is these patients who should be taken for kyphosis correction and instrumented stabilization along with grafting, so that kyphosis progression and the spine heals with a lesser amount of kyphosis, because kyphotic correction surgery is easier in an active stage than in the healed stage, and these patients should be corrected. Lumbar and cervical spine deformity, well, since there is a normal lordosis, any kyphosis is an issue. So late onset paraplegia may not be that big a problem for lumbar spine, but severe lumbar canal stenosis, and one could see here this lumbar kyphosis long standing as a result of childhood TB spine, and this patient is so disabled with the lumbar spinal canal stenosis, cannot stand erect, and hence it's an issue. And severe degeneration, and that is why lumbar kyphosis or cervical kyphosis, we should have a threshold for correction at a lesser deformity, and we should correct them in active stage of disease. Well, coming to pod spine with neural deficit, you put it for 15 minutes or 10 minutes? Yeah. Pod spine with neural deficit. Paraplegia with active disease. Should we decompress all paraplegias? Well, we all know that 30 to 40% improved neurologically on non-operative treatment, and hence judicious combination of conservative therapy and surgery is the rule. And this is the documented evidence that this cord compression has completely resolved on non-operative treatment. One could see it here. So that means we must know pre-operatively or pre-treatment that which are the patient are going to respond on non-operative treatment. Those who have a relatively preserved cord size on MRI, those who have only cord edema or myelitis, and those who have a predominantly fluid collection in extradural space, and there is no evidence of panvertebral disease, that destruction of or inflammation of anterior and posterior column. These patients are going to improve on non-operative treatment. While a dry lesion, where there is a mixed granulation tissue which is encircling all around the spinal cord with a thick dura arachnoid complex with shrunken cord and myelomalacia, these are the patients should be taken for immediate surgical decompression on day one, and one should not wait even for a day if you have confronted one such case. Well, TB spine in children, it's not the same as in adult, because in children, destruction is more because bones are cartilaginous. Early and severe deformity occurs. Deformity progresses with growth, and surgery also affects the growth potential. Well, in children, destruction is more because these all bones are cartilaginous. And if you look at this example, this is a four vertebral disease, and you could see here in a CT, there is hardly any bone anteriorly. Now, this such a severe destruction of bone, which has occurred a short time, then patient is going to have a very severe early deformity. And unless this spine stabilizes onto the distal spine, this kyphus keeps on increasing. And this kyphus will continue to progress even on treatment. Deformity progresses with growth. We know that if these patients, even the disease has healed, this patient has no active disease, but this kyphus has increased in 3 years' time from this angle to this angle just by unabated posterior column growth, and growth potential anteriorly has been affected. And so also, if there is an asymmetric loading on the disc, then some part of the vertebral body grows faster, some part of the vertebral body grows less, and hence whatever growth dissimilarity, that adds to the kyphotic deformity, and that's how the deformity progresses with growth. And the last is the surgery affects the growth potential, and this is one of the very landmark article where four equally matching group of children, where in one group only anterior radical resection and fusion was done, in another only posterior fusion was done, in third combined anterior and posterior fusion was done, and last only anterior debridement without fusion was done. And on a long-term follow-up, those patients who had only anterior radical resection, they had a very severe progression of kyphosis, while there is only anterior debridement was done, some growth potential was retained, and hence they had a less severe progression of kyphosis. So the worst result was anterior fusion alone, and the best was anterior debridement without fusion. So that puts us that yes, radical anterior surgery destroys the anterior growth potential and limits the capacity for spinal remodeling, and it should be avoided, and posterior element do contribute some to the growth. And so if we put all this, that what is the management principle once child comes to us? Well, we have a treatment principle. Drug therapy remains the same as for adult, except doses, because these children have the doses for the ATT for children has been categorized into four weights category: 0 to 10 kilogram, 10 to 17, 18 to 25 and above. And that's how we should keep on giving ATT doses depending on those weights category. And we start ATT today, in 3 months time child is going to gain weight, and hence we have to keep on modifying the dose schedule. We have to watch for toxicity of drugs, certain ethambutol, if you are giving it for longer time, because these children may not be able to complain the problem. So general principle of management of TB spine in children remains the same as for adult, as far as indication of surgery for with or without decompression, with or without paraplegia, but we need to be watchful for kyphosis in children. And what are those cases? There are three scenarios in children. One is patient with active disease, no kyphosis, patient with active disease and kyphosis, and patient with healed disease and kyphosis. Now, those patients with active disease and no kyphosis, treatment principle, diagnosis, drug therapy, same as for adult. DB spine without neural deficit, non-operative, with only few indication of surgery, and when neural deficit, indication remains the same as for adult. Disease will heal, but kyphosis, it's going to progress. Is it going to progress or not to progress? That we have to be watch, and hence this patient should not be discharged from your care unless they achieve a complete growth. And for that understanding, we need to know the natural history of disease. Well, Rajashekaran has given this wonderful article where a natural history of kyphotic deformities in children has been evaluated on a long-term basis. And according to that, if there is a facet toppling, retropulsion, or a translation of spine as a result of panvertebral disease, or a toppling sign where the distal healthy vertebrae meets the distal healthy vertebrae proximally, then this kyphus is going to progress. Summarily, unless this part of the spine makes a bone block on the distal part of spine, whatever is being, this spine is going to collapse onto the distal spine. And when there have a point loading, then some part of the vertebral body is going to grow lesser, and other part is going to grow faster, and it's going to add to the kyphosis, and hence this kyphosis is going to increase. Another reason which has not yet been reported. This child's mother came to me, that child was responding very well to ATT, but mother says that when child sleeps, he is comfortable. When child stands up, child bends over onto the body. And if you look at carefully, there is as if a pseudo-arthrotic segment in the disease segment. And probably this was a massive disc which is not allowing to make a bone block formation. And this spine was on standing and lying down, there was an increase in kyphosis of almost 20 degree. And hence these kind of patients, they should be taken up for stabilization. And this is what the example I would suggest. And these patients should be taken for deformity corrections. Well, in children, the putting an implant is an issue because the profile of pedicle screws sometimes have a lot of problems. So I always prefer a hard shell. But then we know that hard shell is not a load-bearing implant, and we have to be sure unless this good bone block forms interiorly, good, this spine needs to be protected in any way, and child should not be allowed to load vertically. Well, for lumbar and dorsal spine, one can always put a pedicle screws. So kyphosis correction in active disease, the principles are removal of internal salient, shortening of posterior column, instrumented stabilization, anterior bone grafting, and posterior bone grafting. Well, a last word about the late onset paraplegia. Well, it is not uncommon for us to get a very severe kyphosis reaching to us 10 to 15 years later, which have been treated adequately, and they develop paraplegia now. And if you look at this MRI, there is no disease, active disease, in any evidence of active disease. Look at the axial scan, one could see there is no evidence of disease, and this is a shrunken cord. Now, this is a very difficult situation to treat, and as of today, if you look at this reconstructed CT, the spontaneous posterior fusion generally takes place in these patients, and hence removal of internal salient is done with a putting a good amount of bone graft so that one achieves remove the internal salient onto the spinal cord, and the objective here is to have some neural recovery or stop progression of neural deficit in these patients. And that's all you could see here, even some amount of deformity has been corrected. So friends, to conclude, I have discussed scenario from early diagnosis to TB spine with deformity with neural complication to TB spine in children to late onset paraplegia. Every scenario has different issues and rationality of treatment, and we have to have a different consideration for every patient. Thanks very much indeed for patient hearing.